It might be one of the strangest archaeological missions ever undertaken in the Himalaya.
I do see you waving, and that looks like the right place in the caves we were talking about.
Okay, great.
A team of climbers and scientists is rappelling into caves no one has entered for centuries.
Basically, if you come straight down, about 10 meters is where the first set of caves are.
Dr. Mark Aldendurfer is an archaeologist searching for the ancient dead.
Here come the rocks, watch out.
Mark is on a quest to find the remains of the earliest people to have come to the Himalaya. They left no written words, just caves carved high into the walls of cliffs and their mummified bodies. Mark isn't a climber, so he has to rely on experts to access the extreme burials.
Hey, Mark, you copy?
I copy, Matt.
We have bones.
Well, very nice. What kind?
Part of a vertebra, a scapula,
and it looks like the sacrum, lower back.
Excellent. Very good. Keep us posted.
Searching here for ancient bones means they're humbled by wind, altitude, and climbing conditions that threaten their lives.
Watch the children.
Now, climb into the past and ask why the ancient people buried their dead in cliff caves and confront an unnerving link between the living and the dead.
Dada,
yeah,
what are zombies?
In the search for answers, will evidence of a surprising death ritual reveal the identity of the first cave people of the Himalaya?
Good God, that's a cut mark. Why are they doing this?
Funding for this program was provided by.
Explore new worlds and new ideas through programs like this. Made available for everyone through contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
High plateaus and mountains are some of the last places on Earth humans settled. The rarefied air wreaks havoc on people and the land. Few eke out enough of a living to survive. What if we could catch a momentary glimpse into the past and see who first settled here? Look into the faces of the cave people of the Himalaya. By exploring how they buried their dead, could we figure out who they were and why they came here?
The real issue is trying to understand when people came, where they came from, how they got here. All of these kinds of anthropological questions about human migration, movement across landscapes, especially in a landscape like this, which is really difficult.
Archaeologist Mark Aldendurfer has spent the past 5 years trying to connect the bizarre burial rituals he's found in the caves with different human migrations here.
What we've been able to do in these field seasons is to really begin to get a sense of the different directions from which people came and occupied the Kalagandaki Valley over the course of the last 3,000 years or so.
The expedition takes place in Nepal, in an ancient kingdom called Mustang. Here, the Kalagandaki River carved a migration route through the Himalaya, connecting China and Tibet with India. Mark believes Mustang was once a crossroads and suspects this river corridor was an important artery linked to the famous east-west trade route, the Silk Road. But he needs evidence to confirm this. Mark hopes to build on a major find uncovered 20 years ago in Mustang by a team of German and Nepali archaeologists. they found a cave tomb called Mebrak. The Mebrak people carved out caves for their dead and placed the corpses in wooden crypts. Ankles were bound with fabric, bodies flexed in a fetal position. The dead were intentionally layered over time, as if in bunk beds. Funerary pots and sacrificed domestic animals were placed nearby. The mummified remains were dated to between 400 BC and 50 AD. Where did these people come from? And were they the first to settle here? The answer is hidden within more cave tombs, where Mark hopes to compare new finds with the death rituals of the Mebrak burials. All expeditions in Nepal begin in Kathmandu, where Mark has an opportunity to look at the Mebrak mummies that are stored here.
Now the mysteries of the past are revealed.
For the first time in 20 years, the Mebrak mummy collection is reopened. Mark has invited Dr. Jacqueline Ng, a bioarchaeologist, to conduct forensics on the bones.
Well, you got some teeth here. Excited?
Mm-hmm. Teeth. Got an ear, too.
Look, they cut for sampling.
Oh, yeah, they did do some sampling.
The German team took DNA samples from the bones in hopes of determining who the Mebrak people were. But the results were inconclusive. Mark will resample using the more reliable teeth.
Major overbite.
Good samples will also give Mark a genetic baseline to compare with other burials he hopes to find.
This is just extraordinary. It's still articulated.
Collagen is still somewhat intact.
Look at the nails. You really don't find things like this very often in the archaeological record. You have to be very fortunate. I mean, there's just nothing quite like having this quality of remains.
It's an amazing collection. It really is something.
Mark believes this collection of naturally mummified corpses is one among many others still buried up in Mustang. In all, 42 individuals were exhumed from the site, and three were children under the age of six. This one was a neonate, less than 6 months old. Although this baby didn't live very long, we know the people of Mebrak persevered. Carbon dating reveals the burials span a period of 450 years, suggesting this culture had adapted well to their high, dry environment.
That is unbelievable.
Corey Richards plays two roles on the expedition, both climber and photographer. He's helping document all cave artifacts and will photograph the story for National Geographic magazine.
This is the tooth I want. They're really hard to get out.
Yes.
Teeth carry data, in addition to DNA, that will help Mark determine where each individual was born.
I have to resort to major surgery here.
The bone dust is putrid, a good indicator that usable DNA still remains.
Want a knife?
Got a knife? That's great. Thanks, Ben. This is perfect for doing this.
You're cutting the tooth.
Yeah,
right?
I know, but I had to do it to get it out in this case.
You did it?
Yeah, I did. So that's RM2.
Mark's objective: find more burials, especially teeth. They're up there, buried somewhere, deep in the caves of Mustang. The expedition is headed to the hinterlands, cave territory the team has never explored. Porters will carry 65-pound loads, while pack horses take on double. The loads are a mix of climbing gear, camping equipment, food, and film cases. Six 71 loads translates to 25 horses, 10 porters, 6 horsemen, and 5 cook staff, all part of the supply train for a 20-day expedition. A journey through Nepal's Kali Gandaki Valley can be epic, but for some people, it's a way of life. The expedition is led by 7-time Everest climber and National Geographic grantee, Pete Athens, and will be documented by his wife, filmmaker Liesl Clark. Their children have spent a good part of their lives here, schooled on the trail.
Step on. This is the new trekking style.
Big wall climber Matt Siegel also entertains the younger expedition members. From an airstrip at 8,000 feet, the team has journeyed north up the Kali Gandaki River. En route, they'll pass some 50 cave systems they've explored on previous expeditions. Destination? The northernmost village of Mustang, called Samzong, at 14,000 feet.
Jackie!
Just before reaching the village, 7-year-old Finn finds bones scattered along the river.
Definitely not human.
Yeah,
cat. Yeah, it's a right cow femur. Sharp eye, those kids of yours.
Next comes a clue that they've come to the right place.
Finn found this humerus of a human. You can see it's a proximal humerus on the right. Don't know what context this comes from. Maybe washed down from somewhere.
They're told they're the first foreigners to camp in the village. Most of the men are away, treating their goats at the border with Tibet. The team is given permission to explore a set of shallow caves just above where Finn found the human arm bone. Jackie and Mark's Nepali counterpart, archaeologist Mohan Singh Lama, find several bones just below the caves.
These bones are inside the caves. Later, when the caves collapsed, all these antiquities or bones came down in the reach of the river.
This is the fibula, which is the side bone, a right rib. Here's an adult fourth metacarpal, which is part of the palm. At least 3 individuals. The way I can tell that is that you see 2 adult left femora, the thigh bone, so there's 2 adults at least, and then a juvenile left. So that makes at least 2 adults and then 1 juvenile.
At the base of the cliff sits a huge slab with remnants of caves that recently collapsed. Countless bones and artifacts could be crushed underneath. As Jackie and Mohan start piecing together individuals, it's obvious exploring the eroding caves is urgent. The climbers place anchors above the caves to safely access them top down.
The climbing conditions were particularly loose, so we were driving our big rebar pitons just directly into the sides of the cliff. We set them up really far apart because we're never really sure if a whole block 50 feet tall isn't just going to collapse and roll over the cliff face.
With the remains of 3 individuals recovered below, the hope is that there's still something left of what could be a burial tomb.
I have 1 human skull.
At least 1 skull is still lodged above. The team's permit doesn't allow for traditional excavation. They're conducting what's called rescue archaeology, recovering only what's on the surface.
Let me ask you this. In the room, do they seem to be just scattered everywhere, or just are they concentrated in one place or another?
He's always talking to me about context. I need context for where you find things, how you find things, what they look like. So the first thing I do is I start taking pictures and rotating the camera incrementally in a 360. This is the visual record of exactly how we found it. Whether it's been disturbed or not before us, we don't know. But this is how we found it.
We've wrapped into 2 chambers that are connected that have what appear to be human remains, animal as well, and some wood remains.
The wood is the first significant link to the mummy caves of Mebrak. It could have been used for similar style burial bunk beds. In Mebrak, hand-hewn wooden boxes were fashioned as coffins. The wood here suggests that the Samson people may have followed the same tradition.
Corey, can you do a rough and ready sketch map of where you see things?
What we've done effectively is to divide this whole crypt here into three separate parts. What we want to do is to quickly draw, label, and then number, and then get them down to the scientists. But most importantly, if we don't capture the context, we lose a lot of information.
Keep your eyes open for the bunk beds that they were hanging out on.
Another clue emerges that seems to link the Samson to the Mebrak people. Domestic animals were sacrificed to accompany the humans in the afterlife.
Four animals' skulls and one human skull.
It's just very, very disorganized up here. Like piles of bones and material all over the place. It's just been kind of imploding on itself. We're just sending down the human remains, but we also have piles of animal bones, mostly goat.
Excellent!
A 200-foot descent to the world of the living below. Everyone, it seems, has a stake in the remains. Most important for Mark are the teeth. The first skull, toothless.
There's a little tooth fragment in there. Oh, well.
Yeah.
Jackie assembles the bones anatomically, trying to puzzle together complete people to get an accurate count.
So here's the parietal, occipital. So like this part, the skull. Here's the face. So it goes like this.
These people are really pros at losing their teeth. There's just no teeth left whatsoever, but the bone has all been reabsorbed and it's all closed again. All those teeth on top are gone. Oh boy.
Gummy.
Yep, gummy.
Where's my DNA?
So, at least three individuals, right? So we've got at least two different adults, based on the duplicates of the scapula, duplicates of the pelvis, and then one juvenile. So at least three individuals within this hall.
The bones, for Jackie, are like reading the personal diaries of the deceased.
They're basically the only physical evidence of these people. They're recording the history of these peoples in terms of the diseases they survived, the fractures that they might have had in earlier in life, the types of food they were eating, everything that they experienced in life kind of gets recorded onto their skeletal structure as it's trying to adapt to that particular time in history.
Finally, for Mark, the promise of viable DNA.
Oh, more teeth, score.
I'm very happy to see that there's a tooth in this individual. Hasn't lost all of his teeth yet.
The best part of it all, and the most exciting part, is that yes, the cave tombs had human remains, and yes, they have the right kind of material for us to extract the DNA, human teeth. And so this is an integral part of the project that we're trying to develop here. By getting those teeth, it's going to really begin to help us understand who these people are and where they came from and when that all happened.
Archaeologists also look for exceptional stories written onto bones.
The skull is intact, except there's a large piece missing, and you've got these radial, fractures coming away from that spot. It's quite curious.
It looks like it could be a bash and then radiating fracture.
That's kind of what I was thinking, is that the person might have been hit in the head with something very hard.
Yes, it's possible.
Bone fractures could be evidence of violence in the culture, or confirmation that because of rockfall, this is a perilous place to live.
Mark just told us we got exactly what we came here for.
Yeah.
I wish we could take a shower, but
But we can't.
This little stream right here is as close as we're going to get to running water.
That's a bath right there.
There's the rapid.
Yes.
Best on today.
Fantastic. Great, thank you so much.
Yeah, what a day, huh?
Two skulls were literally coming out of the wall.
I felt like we took another major incremental step back into time. Amazing day.
The really brownish one.
Oh, yeah.
I just saw the top of it and sort of brushed around it, and it has teeth, and it only has one sort of hole in the side here, but it's
We have some interesting thoughts about that. It looks like we think maybe that person got smacked in the head.
Oh, yeah.
Because there's a radial fracture that comes right away from the suture, and the suture is detached as well. That might be a blow.
The plan is to return in the morning. Only half of the caves have been explored. Jackie needs a large field lab to lay out the Samsung bones in discrete piles according to which cave they came from.
I'm just setting them up in this dome tent with gaffer tape separating the different piles that we collected. Then so within each wedge of the pie, I'll try to determine the number of individuals within each. Once that's been established, I can begin basic demographic information, age, sex, then later even more in-depth data that can tell us about the health of the people living there.
People carved these caves because this was their cultural pattern on how to deal with the dead. This is how they see placing people into the afterlife. You know, we Westerners often put ourselves in cemeteries. These folks here created a different kind of cemetery, what I would call a communal tomb, where they would put family members into these caves and use them again and again as part of their ritual practice.
The bone rescue mission today is quite delicate.
I think we're looking at one or perhaps two individuals here. Definitely some animal bones accompanying. Looks like a lot has fallen out of here.
It's a pendulum ballet for a dancer trying to leap onto a stage with a ceiling half his size. Whether by looting or erosion, the material culture is long gone from this cave. Burial artifacts like jewelry and pottery that would have accompanied the dead into the afterlife. After 2 days of rescue archaeology, the team recovered remains from a minimum of 27 individuals. Four are children under 6 years of age. Most are adults over 20.
We found eight or so individuals in the very shallow cave. I can't even say they would have lasted this monsoon. I don't know if they, after a month or two in a heavy rainstorm, wouldn't have washed into the river.
Here's the one, the skull that's been grinning at us all this time. A lot of these have that fracture in there. I wonder if that's just, you know, something had fallen on them when the cave collapsed.
Jackie found that 3 out of the 12 crania recovered had fractures.
They walked through the village.
Each had suffered blunt force trauma that healed in life. 2 out of the 3 were women. Through Jackie's bone analysis, we have a clearer picture of how the early Samsung people lived. Little about their agrarian life has likely changed in the hundreds of years that have passed. Their ground-down teeth suggest they had a lot of grit in their diet, probably grain-based, like today, where the staple crops are wheat, barley, and buckwheat. After cleaning and scrutinizing each bone, Jackie detects a disturbing detail.
So I hear you have some interesting discoveries to relate.
I noticed this from like the very first haul bag. There's a couple of...
Good God.
That's a cut mark.
Yeah, so there's two right here.
Here's several along the angle of the rib.
And those are all post-mortem, would you say?
Yeah.
Well, that's pretty interesting.
Yeah.
Any other cut marks anyplace else so far?
Yeah, there's one with 13.
Wow, those are pretty impressive. Okay, so let's figure why are they doing this.
Yeah.
I mean, how do you get a cut mark on the humerus like that?
Definitely a bladed implement.
Clearly there's an attempt to modify the corpse in some fashion, but we just don't know what that process is right now. Theoretically, this all dates to the Mibraq period because of the beds, but on the other hand, it's very different than the Mibraq period because none of those skeletons, as far as we know, had any kind of, you know, post-mortem traumas. So this is something a little different.
Yeah.
Wow.
Although there's evidence of wood coffins and animal bones like Mibraq, the cut marks on the Samsung people point in a new direction. They're distinct from the mummified, intact flesh of the Mibraq people.
See unusual marks here?
Yeah.
They're just very small.
Yeah.
Cut marks? Sometimes that happens in secondary burial ritual practices. Once someone's died, they might leave the burials alone for a while and then process them, which includes some cutting later. Every culture around the world, different time periods, they all have their own unique mortuary practices. It seems to be common in this area to have cave burials, but cutting, I don't know.
You can see this little mark here.
Yeah.
That was probably made by some sort of sharp tool.
Yeah.
Which was taking the flesh
off.
No, no, no.
I asked Mark if I could say that.
Taking off the flesh?
Well, scraping the bones.
Yeah, we don't know if there's stuff like that.
Okay, take two. So Jackie says we can't actually say that they were taking the flesh off. Because we don't know.
Yeah,
we
yeah.
can't say that. I think it's probably highly likely, but I'm not an archaeologist, so I can't say.
Yeah.
Jackie won't call it defleshing until she's investigated every bone. Forensics will tell you a knife can leave many different kinds of marks on a bone.
Here is this cow bone, and what you can see is this very abrupt vertical cut that goes right through the bone. And the only way you can make this cut is with a heavy cleaving instrument like an axe. There's another cow bone, and these cuts are made by a knife that's cutting through the flesh, and it happens to encounter the bone. The effort here is simply to cut meat off of bone, and when you do that, sometimes the knife goes through, hits the bone, and then leaves a scar. That's the kind of cut marks we see at Samsung.
They've stumbled upon a culture no one knows anything about. And Jackie finds that 63% of Samsung's bones have cut marks that clearly indicate defleshing. This practice has never been documented in the Himalaya. It may be linked to the origins of the funerary ritual called sky burial. This death ritual is still widely practiced in Tibet and Mustang today. An offering of one's bones and flesh to sustain the web of life. Vultures are believed to be sacred dakinis, or angels that carry the soul to the heavens. When human populations migrate, they take their mortuary practices with them. Mark thinks the Samsung people were among the first to perform an earlier version of sky burial. But today, the practice has evolved further. Members of the community carry out the ritual on a high hill. The remains of the deceased are dismembered, their bones partly defleshed, crushed into pieces small enough to be carried off by vultures. The earliest recorded account of sky burial is from the 8th century. But carbon dating shows that the Samsung people may have been practicing some rudimentary form of it 300 years earlier. It's similar, but not quite like today's sky burial, where all that remains of the dead are a few shards of bone, along with the haunting marks of charnel tools on stone. A lama from Samsung sees an opportunity.
The local lama was asking for a skull in order to use for tantric rituals.
For hundreds of years, Buddhists have used human bones in rituals surrounding death.
He wants to make a cup for tantric rituals. I mean, there's no guarantee that we can provide that. Does he have a skull he's currently using?
He lent somebody the house and use.
Okay.
So he wants to, his one skull.
Ah, okay, I see. Right now he's borrowing
somebody's home.
It's an absurd conversation from the perspective of Western science. But for a local Buddhist lama, a human skull that is already defleshed has a use.
From an archaeology standpoint, that's horrifically inappropriate.
My opinion is that I would prefer not to do this. But since this is not my country, I have relatively little standing in making this happen. From a scientific standpoint, it's a bad idea.
He cuts just the top off the
top
skull
off the,
and uses that as the cup, right?
Yeah.
In Mustang, skull cups are used in many rituals. Some are adorned with metal and precious stone. This one is sanctified with butter. Bones can carry power, and the skull of someone who died a violent death is considered more powerful due to the restless spirit of the previous owner. Pete, who is Buddhist and also teaching his children about the religion, wants to learn more about defleshing of bones. He seeks out a tulku, a reincarnated holy man whom the people believe has otherworldly powers. The tulku uses human bones in ritual. He may know of past rites involving defleshing. The practice is performed today on human thigh bones. They're used in a ritual called chud, to settle a wandering spirit, or as the locals call it, a zombie.
As I mentioned it before, like about zombies, there used to be zombies.
Zombies, yes.
He's saying that's why there's this squat mark, because they're
Dada.
Cutting all the joints into
Dada.
Different.
Yeah,
what are zombies?
They're like restless spirits that haven't been reincarnated. They're like in a place called purgatory, where they haven't been reincarnated into another life form.
Oh, where do they live?
They just live amongst us.
Like,
but you'd never see them.
Yeah.
Not so much in the skumpa, but they just live amongst us. We'd never see them, because they don't have a body.
Oh.
And the purpose of the chud is the offering of one's body with compassion to these restless spirits.
Chud ritual uses a horn made from a human thigh bone. Often performed before a sky burial, chud ritual is a metaphysical offering of a lama's flesh to the unsettled spirits of someone who has died suddenly. The practice brings the demons under control. The use of a human bone adds to the ritual's potency.
But the best bone will be of someone who just didn't die like normal death, but because of an accident.
The passing of a human life to death and beyond is a transition every culture interprets for its people. And whether there's a nexus between the living and the dead is a spiritual question debated for centuries.
I'm Chinese American, and we still follow the same rituals of going to cemeteries and paying respects to our ancestors. So I'm very much in tune with that sort of spiritual significance that people attach to remains. And I understand that people look at bones and they think, is there some spirit that's still attached to them?
After handling the bones of the dead, and to honor the individuals they once were, the team asks the local lama to perform a special puja ceremony, a sort of purification. As to the lama's search for a skull cup, the villagers decide against allowing him to use one of the 1,500-year-old skulls. There's just enough time left this year to explore one more cave down valley. A new motor road along the ancient trade route cuts travel time in half. While climbing into the last cave, Corey's luck takes a frightening turn.
Hey, so Mark and Jackie just wanted to give you confirm from the ground here. Local authorities are saying that we will have the ship here in about 15 to 20.
While lead climbing, his footholds broke away, and he's taken a bad fall. Corey's sacrum is broken.
He made the circle, and it's over there.
A helicopter is the only option to get him to a hospital. Local police give clearance for the landing.
Passport number?
It's over there.
Pete has given an injection for the pain. The situation suddenly gets worse. The helicopter hits a power line. Live wires could be caught in the road. They have to find a place to step over the wires without getting electrocuted. The ordeal. Seriously injured climber. River water. Electrical wires.
Watch the children.
Even donkeys carrying fuel. Pete makes sure the pilot is confident his rotors are clear. Just 6 weeks later, this very talented Nepali pilot died in a crash while rescuing a Japanese climber from the mountains. Back in Kathmandu with Corey at the hospital, Mark can double-check the Mebrak mummies to make sure there are no cut marks on their bones.
Well, let's see what we have in here. We have two arm bones from an individual seven. So let's see what they look like. Ooh, young person. Problem is there's still flesh on me, so it'll be hard to really see. Yeah. What do you think?
Vessel. This person's under 12.
So I'm not seeing a whole lot of cut marks on these people.
This is, looks like a rodent gnaw mark.
Yeah. These people are different. The ones from Samsung have lots of cut marks that are quite apparent, and these don't. So it's a different kind of mortuary practice that's taking place here. The mystery deepens.
Based on their mortuary practices, the mysterious Mebrak and Samsung people are distinct from each other. Mark is beginning to piece together a continuum of early death rituals. 1600 years ago, in 400 AD, the Samsung people are stripping their dead of flesh and placing them on wooden structures and cave tombs. 800 years before that, the Mebrak people are also burying their dead on wooden bunk bed style cave graves, though their dead are fully fleshed. Other evidence emerges that suggests an even earlier people came here. Ceramics found in Mustong date from nearly 1,000 years before Mebrak. When he returns for a final year's research, Mark's hope is to find the earliest people's bones. 9 months later, Corey has recovered, and the team assembles again for a trip up the Kalijandaki. A big-wheeled truck is the quickest means of transport along the riverbed. In the aftermath of Corey's fall, everyone's anxious about safety. But this is a window of opportunity they have to take. To access the caves, they must cross the river that at any other time of the year would be impossible to forge. En route, Mark wants to take another look at the ceramic evidence of the mysterious people they're searching for. The pottery has been dated to 3,000 years ago in a style known as Chokopani. If he can find a burial with both these ceramics and bones, he will have found the remains of the earliest settlers.
Wow, look at all of them. And so all of these vessels came out of the cave, yeah?
Yeah, yeah.
Mark's partner, archaeologist Holly Moyes, is an expert in ceramics.
This is a very basic pottery technology right here. This is kind of the beginning of pottery technology in a sense, because you're making things by hand, you're not making them on a wheel, and then you're pit firing them, you're not putting them in a kiln.
These things are perhaps especially for the dead to bring them into the graves when someone goes. And so, you know, they make these pots at that time.
If they find the Chokopani ceramics on the ground, they'll look for burial caves above.
Once you find those ceramics, then the question really is, can we then go into the caves that are associated with them or nearby and then get a sense of whether or not those are really mortuary caves or not?
Again, Finn finds a critical clue.
Whoa, what you got? This is stuff that is Chokopani or Mabrak era, you know, as early as 3,000 years ago and maybe as late as, 400 BC or so, but this is the early stuff. So there's an early occupation here, so that means you guys got to go in those caves and find the stuff. Be safe, though, okay?
We're going to do our best.
Don't be falling off this cliff for science.
As soon as Pete and Matt access the caves, they find something striking.
I got some really crazy pottery up here that's engraved with daggers.
Daggers? Well, that's pretty cool. So get some good photos of that, please.
They also find bones, including a mandible with good teeth for sampling.
We've just uncovered a human jaw
with intact lower molars.
Then, Matt finds a hole that looks like a burial.
It sure does sound hollow. Do you think we can get Mark up in here? Should we try to do that?
You need to bring your hand out, but not really up towards the device that much. Mm-hmm. You'll just be letting the rope slip through your right hand.
So this rope is slipping through my hand here as I bring it forward.
As you bring it forward and out, this will then come back into your hand. Just try to go back now.
If I just go straight off, I don't have to look down, do I? Whoa, hold on. Sorry.
Mark has rappelled only twice in his life.
Thanks, Pete.
I really want to get in these caves now, regardless of any kind of fears I have about hanging on the end of a rope. I need to be in there to see exactly what the context is and get a sense of what was going on in that site.
There you go, just kind of slide in there.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Nice work.
I appreciate your,
your
good services on this, gentlemen. Can you hand me my trowel, please?
Mark uncovers layers of material below flat capstones. The stones, now jumbled, covered over successive layers of what appears to be a burial, called a pit tomb. It looks like a vertical shaft with a corpse at the bottom, then progressively layered with sticks, stones, and humans. Mark thinks there are more layers and bodies below. Mark has bones, but he doesn't have ceramics, and it looks like looters have plundered the burial.
It's just been completely chewed up by the looters that came in here and started robbing.
Hidden within a layer of sticks, Matt finds a means to date the cave.
Pretty fully packed pot.
Pete and Mohan measure the cave and sketch map it so they have a clear reference to correlate with Corey's photos.
We're all set in here?
I think so.
Okay, see you in a little bit. Have fun digging in the dirt.
The bones from this cave, called Riri by the locals, tell us there are at least five individuals buried here. Four adults and one child between 3 and 7 years old, and there are likely more. Mark can't be sure just how old the burials are until he and Holly have a chance to analyze the pot and other ceramics found in the cave.
So this is all stuff that we got off the surface. This stuff on this side came from the caves. This is a beautiful vessel. It was obviously handmade. You can even see the finger marks on the inside where they pinched it. So like my finger fits right in there. So I can see where the people went around and pinched this pot.
And we know from the German Nepali project that these date to anywhere between 1000 BC and maybe 450 BC. And so that's Chokopani ware. These pots that came out of the tomb are also Chokopani ware. And so that's why we believe that some of the tomb contents date to Chokopani times. This is supposed to represent some of the original inhabitants of the Kalagandaki Valley.
Teeth hold DNA, but that's not all. Your teeth trap critical information about you from the day you're born, a sort of internal chemical GPS.
We can take the dental enamel, we can analyze it for something called strontium. It's one of the natural elements. And what variability in strontium isotopes tells you is a very precise geographic location of where you were born.
Lactating mothers drink in strontium from groundwater and pass it on to their infants, and it stays with them for life, providing scientists with a perfect geolocator. Mark's strontium results reveal a surprising detail. While many of the men from Mebrak and Samsung were born here, some of the women were not. They're from the lowlands further south. Mark thinks it was trade that brought them here, that this evidence supports this was a well-traveled crossroads where one could readily find a mate. Perhaps these women married the highland men and then adapted to this high, cold place.
We found these human artifacts.
A last expedition on their permit to Samsung confirmed for Pete and Mark that Mustang was a locus for significant trade.
Looking into the cave, the post of the burial stand.
They finally found the burial artifacts that accompanied the Samsung people in death. The team presents the finds to Nepal's Director General of Archaeology, Bishnu Karki.
And this is the funerary mask. You can see the eyes here.
Glass beads were likely manufactured in the bead-making centers of Pakistan or Southeast Asia.
Interesting paintings.
And a wooden burial coffin very similar to the ones found in Mebrak.
And that's exactly what we hope to find, is what the nature of those trade relationships actually are.
Mark believes it was trade that enabled the early cave cultures to thrive. Passing caravans were a lifeline in a harsh place, bringing seeds, animals, and even wives to make survival here possible. And along with these trade goods, burial traditions came to Mustang too. Remnants of cultures hundreds of miles away.
What we found is that we've got a whole mixture of different kinds of ancient DNA that we recovered from here. Some people are very clearly from the Tibetan Plateau. Other people are very clearly from the Western Himalaya. And a very small number of people appear to be coming from the far south.
Through the obvious trade of goods here, the Kaligandaki was likely a spur to the East-West Silk Road, connecting China with Europe. Although Mark can make sense out of cave tombs and artifacts, there's a lot his techniques can't fully explain. Like Riri's daggers. The daggers are symbolic, to vanquish unsettled spirits. They were likely used as part of a ritual exorcism, suggesting a spiritual connection between the dead and the living.
They're very serious about subjugating their demon. They've got daggers on every surface.
There's always one last cave. This one's the same cave system where Corey fell last year.
There's 18 windows, and they're believed to be sacred texts in the caves. Whether that's true or not, we don't know.
The team is given permission by the nearby villages to explore them once and for all.
That's fine. I trust that.
Pete will belay as Matt leads the climb.
It's not that solid.
Yeah, there's still going to be some mud.
Although everyone wants to know if there are ancient texts in the cave, there's an uneasy connection to the dangerous events of last year.
This time we're going to try and go more on the face, but using that chimney system to aid that progress, and I think it'll be better. The rock looks really solid.
After 3 hours of placing protection up the route, Matt finally approaches the caves. These are the last shots before cameraman Lincoln Else decides to cut so he can run to the base of the caves to climb up and join Matt.
Hey, Liesl, I'm actually gonna cut.
Matt's rope loosened a rock, and seconds later, the world for cameraman Lincoln went black. Pete and Corey held Lincoln in his agony, gloves holding the large crack to his head.
Quite a big laceration on his skull, and his right arm was, he was having problems feeling and understanding what was going on with his right arm, so that could be indicative of some neurological damage, and there was a minor contusion on his brain.
A helicopter extracted Lincoln from the same place Corey was rescued last year.
Why is he going into surgery, did they tell you? Okay, so they're prepping him for surgery.
There's an odd sort of looking for bones and then breaking all these bones seems to be a little bit unnerving.
The issue is there's a piece of bone that's floating right now in basal skull, and they want to go and remove it so that he doesn't have a problem with it later.
Pete asks a lama to perform a puja ceremony. It's a sort of exorcism after he learns from the locals that there's a morbid history to this place.
The story I've heard is about a woman who lived in the Chuksong area who was returning home very late, and she was struck by rockfall that came down the cliff, and she cried out in great pain and great anxiety many hours during the night. The people of Chuksong thought that they were the wails of coyotes rather than a human in distress, so they didn't answer the call. Some people believe that if you die in great pain, if you die in great anxiety in those places, that you become almost a prisoner of those places. You're captive to it and almost shackled to it. And it takes a great act of compassion to liberate a spirit from that place.
They didn't know if Lincoln would survive his injuries, which he ultimately did. The locals felt the spirit, or zombie, of the Chuksong woman needed subjugation.
Say what you will about superstition, but it's a nice feeling to know that if there are some sort of malign spirits in these caves, that we're sort of, you know, taking care of that angle of things. The main purpose of going back up today is to be good patrons of this area. As far as climbing ethics go, you just don't leave gear hanging around. It's not only an ethical issue, but also, you know, I think it poses a serious safety threat to locals, because who's to say that somebody wouldn't try to hand over hand up the rope and end up halfway up and not able to hold on.
The caves were perfectly empty, most likely meditation cells used by Buddhist monks searching for an end to suffering in life and death. Cultures have lived and died here for thousands of years, and each has divined its own rituals for the living left behind to make sense of a brush with death.
Scary stuff happened here yesterday, and scary stuff happened here last year, and so we're just kind of, I'm really trying to overcome that sort of irrational, illogical fear.
The team will come back, but not without pause for reflection on what they've learned about not only the first people who came here, but those who remain, the unique burials of their dead, and their rituals surrounding the fragile relationship that exists between the living and the dead.